Hey, everybody. It is such an honor you've chosen to join with us today. Hi, my name is Eric Bucci, and I'm the lead pastor here at the Cornerstone Church. I trust you had a great Christmas. I am so appreciative of Cornerstone Church and how we all came together. We're able to serve hundreds and hundreds of people for our Christmas candlelight services. So I sure do appreciate everyone's help. And right now, we're in the middle between 2021 and 2022. You know, I think back to 2019, who would have dreamt that 2020 and 2021 would be what we've been going through the last couple of years? And so we don't know what lies ahead, right? And so we want to know, how can we make the next year really count? How do we prepare ourselves for the new year? I don't know how you guys are, but often we make these New Year's resolutions and they go well for a couple of days and they go away. How do we prepare for 2022? How do we make this the best year we possibly can have? I'm praying that 2022 would be an amazing year for you, your family, your friends, and for Cornerstone Church. And I believe that the best days are always ahead in Christ Jesus. So many of us, we're confident that if you're in Christ and you've given your life to Christ, we're really confident that the future's fine. The problem is this: what about today? What about tomorrow? What's going to happen then? That's the hard part, right? I mean, I think we know if you're giving your life to Jesus Christ and you're following God, you know the best days are going to be ahead. But what about tomorrow? What's going to happen tomorrow? What's going to happen this coming year? And if you're like me, you're asking yourself that question: God, what do I do for 2022? How do I prepare myself? You know, it's just amazing to me that when you think about 2022, I find the best thing to do is to go back to the fundamentals. Back to the fundamentals is what makes us strong. And so I want to share with you today, I believe, a verse that can really help us navigate 2022. As we head into this new year, no matter what comes our way, no matter what we face as a nation, no matter what we face with our health, no matter what we face in circumstances and relationships and financial matters, how can you and I be sure that things are going to be good and great? You see, we have an advantage. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ and you've given your life to Christ, we have a promise that holds all things together. You know what it is? It's this. The Bible promises us that all things work together for good for those that love God and are called according to his purposes. That means all things work together for good. I don't know about you, but I want 2022 to work together for good. And that's a promise that God has given us. And I want to encourage us as we navigate, as we get ready for this new year, that we would set God first and foremost in all that we do. And so what we're going to do today is kind of unpack that verse. What does it mean? What do you mean all things work together for good? Are you telling me the last couple of years and all that has taken place, the pain we've gone through, the difficulty, the loss, all these things we've been through the last couple of years, you're telling me that's all working for good? Well, we're going to look at this today, and we're going to demystify it and also show how it really is the Word of God. Okay, everybody? So let's go ahead. Take a moment. If you could gather together wherever you're at, I know it's really easy to be distracted and to go around. I just encourage you just to pay attention for the next 24 minutes or so as we just break this verse down and ask God to change our lives. Let's pray. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, I want to thank you for today. I want to thank you that every person matters to you, every person you love, and you have a purpose and you have a plan for every person. Father, I pray that today as we share your word, that it would change our hearts, starting with all of us, God, that we would be changed by the renewing of our minds and that your word would dwell among us and that we would walk out of here today different and closer to you than we were when we left, when we first came, in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, let's break down today what this actually means in Romans 8:28, perhaps one of the most famous scripture verses in all of the Bible. Here it is. And we know that all things, when the Bible says all things, it means everything. There's nothing exempt. It's your health, it's your relationships, it's the circumstances you surrounding you, all things. The Bible says, and we know. And the word we know is there's confident. And we know that all things work
together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purposes. All things work together for good. Now, that may bother you. You might be thinking to yourself, wait a minute here. What happened to us in the last couple of years? Are you saying that was God's will? I've heard people say this. Well, God's got me this disease because he wants to treat. He wants to give me patience. He wants to teach me something. We might think these various things, but that's not true. You see, God is not an evil God. God is a good God. And just because bad things happen does not mean it's God's will. The Bible says he takes all things and makes them work together for good. It does not say he causes all things to happen, but God can take what took place in our life and make it for good. God can take our ashes and make it something better. God can take our tragedy and turn it into a triumph. God can take your biggest and your darkest and your most horrible set of circumstances and use it to make you better and to make his kingdom happen. This is the promise we have in Christ Jesus. By the way, this promise only is for people who've given their lives to Christ. So let's unpack this together and see what this really means as we hit 2022. Number one, it is an absolute promise. This is a promise. And when the Bible says something, it is not a suggestion. It's not something that we kind of hope for. No, this is an absolute promise. This is the quote, we anchor our lives upon the promises, the facts of God, not our feelings. That is so important. We need to anchor our lives on the facts of God's promises. And God's promise is that all things work together for good. And this is the truth, everybody. We cannot base our life upon our feelings. This is why your mind matters, what you think about. And we have to get our life strong. We have to get our thoughts strong. We have to know the Word of God. It's our lifeblood. It's the anchor that holds us in the storm. I remember reading a story not too long ago about a gentleman who was in the Caribbean with a sailboat, a pretty large sailboat with a crew cab below it. And there was a hurricane coming. And he's like, what are we going to do? They were in a remote island. They had nothing else to do. They had enough moors. They had enough anchors. And what they did, they anchored. They went into the inlet, and they anchored the boat down the best way they could. Multiple anchors. And they made it nice and tight. They had a little slack. And they had to ride out the storm. And the storm came in. It was bad. The ship was going back and forth. They could have been thrown to the rocks. But they made sure that that anchor held. It reminds me of this picture that I see here and how this huge anchor can hold a ship down. They had multiple anchors. Let me just say something. God's word is unchanging. It is a firm foundation. And when you and I, we need to drop the anchor of God's promises and tie our lives to God's promises, because sometimes our feelings are going to scream at us. Our feelings are going to tell us all sorts of things. I can't go on. I cannot do it. But you have to realize that God's word is our anchor. We have to throw our anchor of our faith and begin to train our minds and to get moors, which would be like ropes, and tie ourselves to God's promises that when the storms come, we will survive, and yes, we will even thrive through them. God never promises an easy life, but he does promise us this. He'll never leave us, and he'll never forsake us, even until the end of the age. I want to encourage you with something so true. God will never leave you if you're giving your life to Christ. Jesus said while he was on the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me? He was forsaken so you and I never have to be. So what do we have to do? We have to anchor ourselves in God's promises, no matter what takes place. So it's an absolute promise. All things work together for good. It is a supernatural God promise. This is not just a promise of something we think about and we just kind of meditate on it and hope it works. No, there's something supernatural about this. God can literally change the properties of our life and make it better. He can do things that no one else can do. He can take the most adverse set of circumstances and turn it into something good that is supernatural. My friends, it is not only an absolute promise, it is a supernatural promise of God. It's also an all-encompassing promise. It means it works for all things, the Bible says. All things work together for good. All things.
every single area of our lives, no matter how adverse, no matter how difficult. Listen, everybody, let me just reiterate once again. God does not cause all things to happen, but he can cause all things to work together for good. If I were to take chlorine and drink it by myself, I would get sick and poison myself. Chlorine. Or if I took sodium or chloride, if I took chloride, but you put sodium chloride together, you know what you get? You get table salt. And so two poisonous properties that are combined together make a new element. Two separate entities that are poison within themselves, when they come together through a smashing of together, it creates a compound that brings flavor and brings perseverance and preserves. Salt was very important in the days of the ancient. And so what God can do, everybody, he can take all these horrible sets of circumstances and he can put it in his collider, if you will, and smash these particles together and create something beautiful at what was a tragedy. God can take the poisonous things of your life, what the enemy meant for evil. God can take those things and he can turn it around. I've seen it happen so many times. I've seen it happen in people's lives that I've known I knew one person that was a drug addict, on heroin, lost their family, lost everything. But God took those horrible sets of circumstances and he collided it with the Holy Spirit. And God raised up a ministry that affected thousands of people because somebody believed the truth that all things work together for good. God can take your biggest pain, your biggest tragedy, your biggest shame, and if you'll give it to him, he'll collide it supernaturally, and he can change those poison compounds to a beautiful concoction that brings healing to other people. That's the beauty of the word of God. All things work together for good. And what we call this, this is called synergy. When you say all things work together in the Greek, that phrase, we actually get basically the word synergy, and is the interaction or cooperation of two or more organizations, substances, or other agents to produce a combined effect greater than the sum of their separate parts. God can take horrible sets of circumstances and literally change them. What was once a pain can become a gain. Now, I'm not just trying to rhyme to be cool. I'm telling you the truth here, everybody. He can change these properties of your lives. And what we got to do, however, we have to give God the pain. We have to surrender to him the difficulties and say, God, I hate this pain. Give it to him. Surrender to him and watch what God can do. He can multiply. He can change the very composition of what you're going through. He's the same God that let Peter walk on water. Literally, the composition of that water changed when Peter walked on it because God did a miracle. We serve a supernatural God. What once sunk you, you can walk on if you give it to God. And this is what God can do with our past. So it's an absolute promise. It's a supernatural God promise. It's an all-encompassing promise. All things can work together. And here's the part that people may not like, but it's true. It's an exclusive promise. That's right. This promise is not for everybody. This promise is for those that have given their lives to Jesus, who love God. All things work together for good for those who not go to church. It says all who love God. You see, you can be a Christian and not love God very much. I'm not suggesting that we're going to have eternal separation. But when you love God, it changes something. Love covers a multitude of sins. Love, agape love, is so incredible. The Bible says the greatest of these is faith, hope, and love, and the greatest of these is love. When we let God's love touch us, it is so supernatural, it changes things. So I encourage you, don't try to be a Christian, it doesn't work. Don't try to be good, it doesn't work. What I'm encouraging you all to do, and I'm encouraging myself to do, fall more in love with God. And you're like, well, how am I supposed to do that? The good news is this. You're designed by God for God. And so when you spend time with God, and not just spend time with God religiously, like trying to make it happen, but make sure, God, I want to know you more. God, I want to love you more. And what he'll do is the more you connect to God, the more alive you'll become. And God can change the toxicity of your past and of horrible situations and turn it to something good. It is an exclusive promise. An exclusive promise to who?
to those who love God.
My friends, that is the key. Cornerstone Church, and we're not about religion. We're not about going to church. We're not about paying tithes, going on mission trips, and trying to be a good person, trying to stop doing bad things. Listen, if you spend your life doing that, you'll never, ever get to the right place. You'll have the wrong motivations, and it will be misery. But really, the key is this. We learn to love God. And how do we do that? We let God love us. And so those who love God, and the scriptures are very clear on it. That is why the scriptures mean when they say, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, and no mind has imagined what God has prepared for those who what? You can say it out loud. Love those who love him. In Deuteronomy 7:9, I'm just going to show you some scriptures quickly, is this. Understand, therefore, that the Lord your God is indeed God. He is the faithful God who keeps his covenant, that means promise, that he keeps, for 1,000 generations and lavishes his unfailing love on those who what? Who love him and obey his commandments. That's right. You see, we don't obey his commandments just to obey his commandments. We do it because we love God. That's the key, everybody. Obeying his commandments is important. Why? Because if we disobey God's commandments, the disobeying of the commandments will break you. If you break the laws of nature, the laws of nature will break you. God has designed us. Not only is there natural law, but there's relationship laws. And if you break those laws, you deem harm to yourself, not because God's against you, because you go against God's design, his spiritual design, his natural design, and you go against that, you hurt yourself, and he loves you so much. He says, trust me and obey my commandments. If you obey what I'm telling you, then you really love me. So if you really love me, you want to obey my commandments. It's not about trying to obey the commandments, but loving him first. And that gives you the power to do. And 1 John 5:3 says this, loving God means keeping his commandments. Listen, everybody, we're not trying to earn our salvation. Let me make something very clear. Jesus paid for our sins. So I'm not talking about salvation. God saved us for good works. God saved you so you could become the man or woman he's created you to become. And so when we follow his commandments, what you're doing is you're following the way things are ought to be. And it's perfect and it's best way. You do that, you prosper. I hope you understand what we're talking about here. When you ride your car on a road that is made for an asphalt road, it's great. But if you take your car, your sports car, and you drive on a rocky terrain and you don't pay attention, your car is not made for that. That's made for a four-wheel drive. And so what happens? You break the commands of that design, you damage the vehicle. And so, my friends, it's the same thing. God says, if you love me, you'll obey my commandment because I have good plans for you, a hope and a future. 1 John 5:3 says the following, for every child of God defeats this evil world. And we achieve this victory through our faith. And who can win this battle against the world? Only those who believe that Jesus is the Son of God. That's how we defeat it. Why? Because we love him, we obey his commandments. And when we do this, we have the capacity and the ability to do what our design is. Our design is to be overcoming people through the kingdom of heaven. This is what we're called to do. And James 1:12 says this, God blesses those who patiently endure testing and temptation. Afterwards, they will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who what? Love him. You see, we do have to take the long view in all that we're doing. So in 2022, I want to tell you something. God's word always works. The right thing is always the right thing. Trust God. In 2022, this is what we want to do. This is the big view of what we want to do and how we can have a successful and amazing 2022 is to trust God in all that we do. Love him. Make it the priority of everything that we do. You see, it's an exclusive promise to those who love God and those who are called to his purpose. That's right. We believe, every single one of you, myself included, were created on purpose for a purpose. One of the purposes of Cornerstone Church is to help people to discover their purpose. That's our job as a church. You see, when we're all together and we work together, you begin to find ways that someone is built. Often when we come in community and we work together, we discover our purpose, what God has created you for. You see, we believe every single person matters to God. If you're a janitor in a high school, if you're a doctor, if you're a lawyer, if you're a student, if you're a teenager, God has called each of us for a specific purpose. And what's so great about it is it's custom made for you. God's not asking you or me to be anyone else but the person he's created, the man or the woman he's created us to be. So we're called to his purposes, and he works all things. And we know that all things work together for good for those who love God and to those who are what? Called according to his purposes. When we trust God, and no matter what takes place, God can turn a tragedy into a triumph. And look at the life of Joseph. I don't know if you're familiar with Joseph in the book of Genesis. Joseph, one of the most amazing men in the Bible. God gave him great promises. His brothers were jealous of these promises, and they sold him to the Midianites. And so for over 17 years, he was separated from his family. God gave him two dreams that's going to make him a great, great leader. And what happens? The next thing you know, he's sold into slavery. He's found in a pit. All the promises are falling apart. The next thing you know, he works in a place called Potiphar's house. He kind of worked hard. And this is really important, everybody. You can either get bitter or you can get better. We mentioned that a couple of weeks ago. Remember, when you're bitter, you focus on the eye. Bitter. But when you get better, you focus on eternity. And what did Joseph do? Joseph did the best job he could do. He did his work unto the Lord. He worshiped God in the pain. Was it difficult? Absolutely. But instead of getting bitter, he got better. And what happened? He became the top slave in Potiphar's courts. He was doing everything right. Then Potiphar's wife, I call her Hotifer. Potiphar's wife, Hotifer. She was going after Joseph. And she said, Joseph, I want you to lay down with me. I want you to basically have relations, sexual relations with me. He's like, I can't do that. I can't do that. I got to obey God. And so she kept pestering him and pestering. One day she demanded he come with her. And Joseph's like, you know what? I'm not going to negotiate with sin. So he didn't sit there and sit down to Potiphar or Hotiphar's wife and go, hey, Hotiphar, let's discuss this. Now, what did he do? He said, I'm out of here. I got to trust God. I'm going to flee from evil. So he ran away and left his jacket behind. Of course, if you don't know the story, she blamed Joseph and claimed he tried to rape her. So Potiphar found out about his wife, Hotiphar. Actually, we don't know what her name is. I just did that for a play for words. But anyhow, so he got thrown into prison. Horrible. So here he goes again, another bad circumstance. Why would God allow? So what did he do? He worked the best while he was in prison. You know what he did? I'm going to serve God in prison. I'm going to be the best prisoner anyone has ever seen. And you know what happened? As he began to serve God, he got better, not bitter. Listen, everybody, you can't control what happens to you, but you control how it controls you, how it affects you. And what he did, he kept it in faith. All through the book of Genesis says, Joseph was in prison, but God was with him. Listen, everybody, but God is with you. If you give your life to Christ, he is with you. No matter what you go through, remember, God is with you in the middle of the hell you're going through. God is with you. Understand it. Believe it. Embrace it. And God can take that horrible circumstance and turn it for something good. And that's what happened to Joseph. Finally, Joseph interpreted a couple of dreams to the prisoners. Oh, good. I'm getting out of here. More time goes by. Finally, the baker I remember what happened. There's this guy who actually, he remembered what I dreamt. He remembered what happened. And so he called him to Pharaoh. He interpreted Pharaoh's dreams. And what happened is he saved a generation of his own people and he saved Egypt. God took the pain. All things work together for good for those that love God and are called according to his purposes. This is what happened with Joseph. In fact, I would say the Old Testament equivalent to Romans 8:28 is found in Genesis 50:20. And this is what Joseph said when his brothers came back and he had a chance to really get even with those guys. He could have punished them. He could have tortured them. This is what he said. This is what he says to his brothers. But as for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good. They did evil, but God took those chemical compounds that were poisonous. He smashed them together supernaturally, and God turned it for good. Now, what would have happened if Joseph said, nope, I'm going to be bitter. I'm going to hold on to this bitterness. I'm going to hold on to this poison. If he did not release the poison from the inside of him, God could not smash it with another compound to make it something beautiful. Could it be, everybody, that you're holding on to bitterness and I'm holding on to bitterness, things I'm holding on to, holding on to those things. Surrender your pain to God. Let him smash it. Let him combine it. Let the synergy take place. Let God put the chemical compound of his blood, of his love, and change it all. That's what God can do. So we had Joseph. Then we had the Jewish people who went through all kinds of difficulties. I'll just go ahead and read to you in Jeremiah, the weeping prophet. This is after God warned them for hundreds of years, get right with me. Finally, he let the Babylonians take them over, and they were taken into exile. They lost their home. They lost their family. They lost everything. And Jeremiah writes to the people of God and says the following, and he writes to us today as well, says this, for I will set my eyes on them for good. And I will bring them back to this land. God's given a promise. I will build them and not pull them down. And I will plant them and not pluck them up. So in the middle of their duress, God says, I'm going to restore you, but you got to release it unto me. Then I will give them a heart to know me, that I am the Lord, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God. For they shall return to me with their whole heart. God's prophesying. God wants you to return. And you know what he says after that? In Jeremiah 29. A lot of us memorize this one too. Maybe if you haven't heard this before. For I know the plans I have for you, God would say to you today. I know the plans I have for you in 2022, declares the Lord. Plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. Listen, everybody. God's future and hope are good. But what about the in-between time? How do we handle this in-between time? Well, that's a very good question. I want you to look at the life of Jesus. And what Jesus had to go through. And this is what it says in Acts 2:23 as I'm talking about Jesus. Look at the pain he went through and the difficulty and the circumstances were not ideal at all. Look what it says. But God knew what would happen. And his prearranged plan was carried out when Jesus was betrayed. Why would he be betrayed, right? With the help of lawless Gentiles, you nailed him to the cross and killed him. In fact, this has happened here in this very city. For Herod Antipas, Pontius Pilate, and the governor of the Gentiles and the people of Israel were all united against Jesus, your holy servant, whom you anointed. But everything they did was determined beforehand according to your will. That's right. God knew what was going to happen. This is the amazing thing. This is the absolute amazing thing. All hell was unleashed upon Jesus. All hell was unleashed upon Jesus. You see, God took the most awful, satanic thing that could happen and used it for his purpose. Now, we don't know the complete mystery of what took place with Christ and everything that happened and why it happened exclusively. We know have a good idea for what happened. But God took the most satanic thing possible and turned it for something glorious. In fact, check this out. In 1 Corinthians 2:7, it says this. This is what's the amazing part. The enemy of our souls, the enemy, the devil, that's right, the enemy didn't even know what was going on. Check this out. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the ages for our glory, which none of the rulers of this age knew, for they had known they would have not crucified the Lord of glory. In other words, God hid it. Satan didn't even know what the ramifications of what Christ was going to go through, that trying to destroy Jesus brought our redemption. He thought he won. And what happened? God's victorious. All things work together for good. You see that, everybody? Look, think about this. This horrible set of circumstances, the disciples didn't understand it. Not even the enemy understood it. You see, the enemy may try to take you out, may bring you through all sorts of difficulties. But if you'll surrender your pain, if you'll surrender your difficulties, say, God, I give this to you. May you be glorified in it, God. I'm going to believe that somehow, some way, you're going to make this work together for good. And you say, I'm going to believe that truth beyond my circumstances and watch what God would do. You see, in 1 Corinthians 2:7, it says this, but as it is written, No eye has seen, nor ears heard, nor entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him. You may be going through a difficult set of circumstances, but you don't know the long-term significance. It takes time to believe God, and the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. For example, we don't know what God wants us to pray for, but the Holy Spirit prays for us with groanings that cannot be expressed in words. That's why if you have a prayer language, you can ask God to baptize you with his Spirit and pray in your prayer language, and the Holy Spirit will intercede for you with groanings you don't even understand. The Word of God says the Holy Spirit is praying for us. And the Father, who knows all hearts, knows what the Spirit is saying. For the Spirit pleads for us, believers, in harmony with God's own will. And we know that God works all things together. You see that, everybody? You see how that works? When we surrender to God and we say, God, I don't know what's going on, but I'm going to trust you. God, I don't understand what's taking place. And Holy Spirit, teach me how to pray. I don't know how I'm supposed to pray. And even when you don't know how to pray, sometimes you're like, God, what do I do? The Holy Spirit will pray for you. And what can happen is if he prays the will of God upon our lives, this is what God can do for us. And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purposes for them. My friends, I'm asking you a question today. We have a choice. What are we going to do in 2022 as we face what we're going to face? Maybe you're taking back with you in 2021 some pain or difficulties. Let's surrender those pain. Let's surrender those areas of our lives to God. Say, God, I don't understand why this happened. I don't know why I lost my loved one. I don't know why I lost my job. I don't know why I struggle so much with self-control and I can't seem to beat this habit. But I'm going to give you this pain. Watch what God will do. He can take your pain and turn it into your gain for his kingdom. I'm telling you, that's what God is able to do. His word is true. You can bank on it, everybody. You can bank on it. Now, let me just encourage you. Before we do that any further, let me encourage you with something. Have you believed in him? Have you believed in Jesus? Have you given your life to Christ? I want to encourage you to do that today. I can't think of a better way to prepare yourself to 2022 than right now, giving your life to Jesus. It's not about a church. It's not about a religion. It's about a relationship with Jesus. You're not good enough. I'm not good enough. And if you're willing to say, God, I give my life to you, I'm sorry, and you give your life to Christ, you can become his child, his responsibility, and the promise of Romans 8:28 can be yours, that all things work together. So let's go ahead and take a few moments to pray. Father, I pray right now you touch all the hearts that are listening right now. I pray that your kingdom would come and your will would be done in Jesus' name. Father, I pray you'd bring people to a place of knowing who you are. Lord, I pray for the rest of us, Lord, that we'd be willing to give up the pain and let you take the tragedies of our life and supernaturally synergize it to turn our tragedy into your triumph in Jesus' name. Amen. Let me ask you a question. Have you given your life to Jesus? I want to lead you in a prayer today. And it's not a prayer to Cornerstone Church. It's not about me. It's about Jesus. And it's simply this. Christ died for you, and he paid for all of your sins. That if you receive that, you can completely let go of your past. He'll clean everything you've ever done wrong and give you a hope and a future. If you'd like to do that today, maybe you used to walk with God and you're not walking with him anymore, or maybe you've never given your life to Christ. Well, today is the day. I'm going to lead you in a prayer right now. You want to bow your heads? Pray this from your heart right now. That's right. Lord Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross. I believe you're the Son of God. I believe you rose again from the dead. Today, I willingly turn away from what I know is wrong. I ask you to forgive me of all of my sins, all of them. And God, I step down from being in charge of my life. I say, my life is now your life. I give my life to you in Jesus' name. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, we believe you became born again. And there's a number on the screen you can call. You can text it. It's 860 866-499-4888. That's 860-499-4888. And type in believe, and we'll give you the next steps for your faith journey. Okay, everybody, hey, listen, it's been an honor and a privilege that you could join with us today.
Hey, everyone, thanks so much for joining us today. Before you go, we want to give you an opportunity to worship the Lord with your tithes and offerings. There are a number of ways to give at Cornerstone. You can give by texting the word Cornerstone Cheshire to 833-245-5608. Or you can give online at cornerstonecheshire.com. Just look for the giving link at the top right corner on our homepage. Finally, you can give by using the PushPay app. Simply open the app, look for Cornerstone Cheshire, and follow the prompts. Thank you so much for your faithfulness in giving. Would you please join me in a final word of prayer? Father, we thank you so much for your goodness to us. It's our joy to give to you, receive it as our worship, use it to advance your kingdom. In Jesus' name,